Okay, so our next speaker in this session is Stephen Spallone from ICER, again talking about Stiefel Whitney classes of representations. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for this opportunity. It's been a long time since I was since I spoke at ISC. I think I spoke last at a workshop in group theory, or maybe representation theory and probability theory, and out of that came my came a very important paper in this project. Anyway, so I'd like to use this opportunity to give an overview of lots of things I've been working on over the past years with my students and by myself, I guess, and I'll show you kind of the path that led me into this area. And at the end, I'll kind of quickly talk about the different specific results. Anyway, this is my title. Let's see. Okay. So let's say I have a group. So what do representation theorists do? Let's suppose I have a group and all of the irreducible representations are classified, right? That's the first thing you do in representation theory is, presumably, is to find all the representations by making this character table. Now, now typically there'll be some kind of nice parameterization. For example, symmetric groups, the irreducible representations are classified or are parameterized by partitions of N, and Lie groups, say compact Lie groups or connected compact Lie groups, there's a parameterization by weights of a maximal torus, if you know what I'm talking about. Okay, so then what are some other things you can do after that's done? Here's a question. So I'm going to lay out a series of questions. Well, one question is you can say, well, in terms of my parameterization, how do you take duals? You know, the dual of an irreducible representation will again be irreducible. And in terms of the parameterization, what is the dual? So that's a question. After you do that, then you should be able to figure out the second question, which is to list which of these pi are self-dual. When is pi isomorphic to its dual? And, you know, these are, of course, not difficult. You can do this by the character table. Okay, but then we get to this Frobenius-Schur indicator question, which is, suppose I have a self-dual irreducible representation, then it's a consequence of generalities of Schur's lemma that there's a non-degenerate G-invariant bilinear form on the representation space V, which is either symmetric or anti-symmetric, and not both. You either get one or the other. And so from that, you get a HOM from, so G at the representation actually lands inside the isometries of V relative to this bilinear form. And the Frobenius-Schur indicator question is, which one is it? And that's a fun question. In fact, this is how I got into this. Into this line of inquiry is just asking, let's say, I think I was studying p-adic groups at the time, and there was Alan Roche who got me into this project of trying to figure out in the context of p-adic groups, which irreducible self-dual representations were symmetric and which were anti-symmetric. So that's a classic old question, but it's an interesting one. It's not completely obvious because this thing here is not exactly constructive in some sense. Anyway, but we can go further. Okay, so suppose pi v is self-dual and we've determined that it's orthogonal. So I can think of pi as a map from G into the orthogonal group of V. Now there's a non-trivial double cover rho from a group called the pin group. There's a central extension called the pin group, and it's a double cover of O of V, which is well known, especially to physicists. They talk about spin structures. The spinoriality question is, does pi lift to pin of V, right? So I already have a map from G to O of V. Is there a map from G to pin of V so that the triangle commutes? A related question to this is, what is the determinant of pi? Now, the determinant, when I say a determinant of a representation, I'm thinking of a representation as a map to some GL of V, And then I can, there's a home from GL of V into scalars, non-zero scalars, by taking the determinant. And by determinant of pi, I mean the composition. If I have an orthogonal representation, then the determinant is going to be, is going to take values in plus or minus one. So it'll be some home from the determinant of pi will be a home from G into plus or minus one. So that's, I just want to mention that as a related question, and then we'll come back to that later a little bit. Okay, so anyway, so suppose I have this, back returning to the spinoriality problem, suppose I have a home from G into O of V, then because I have this, this double cover, I get what's called a pullback extension of G, a central extension of G by Z mod 2Z, which is, I'll just define it here for you to be clear, using this fiber product construction. So I get a pullback. So I get an extension by of G by Z mod 2Z. And let's assume you know group cohomology. Then you would know that from such an extension is associated a cohomology class, something inside H2 of G with coefficients in Z mod 2Z. I'll write that as W2 of pi. So that's the cohomology class associated to this pullback extension when I pull back the pin double cover. Now, if the determinant is, now suppose that the determinant is one, I determine the representation is one, then pi is spinorial if and only if e pi is a trivial extension. I mean, that part doesn't need determinant pi equals one, but if, and that's if and only if W2 of pi is zero. Okay, so this W2 of pi. Now there's also some first cohomology going on here. So when I write this group cohomology with coefficients in Z mod 2Z, I'm considering that as a trivial G module. And it's a familiar fact that there's an isomorphism, there's naturally an isomorphism from the Hom group to H1. And we can call that W1. I'm going to call that Hom W1. Now, when pi is orthogonal, the determinant of pi is a Hom from G to plus or minus one, which I can view as Z mod 2Z. And so I can define W1 of pi to be W1 of the determinant of pi. So here, I'm, you know, the domain here is just these linear characters, but I can extend that to a map on representations and orthogonal representations by simply just considering the determinant. Okay, so now so these questions of the determinant and the spinoriality problem fit into a program, fit into a framework, what's called Stiefel-Whitney classes. So for an orthogonal representation of G, there are Stiefel-Whitney classes. And there's a sequence of them. There's one for each non-negative integer k, and they satisfy the following properties. And I should say that the Stiefel-Whitney classes is well known to topologists. I think it was first maybe understood in terms of vector bundles, where I would be taking the usual cohomology of the base space, and then to a vector bundle is associated to a real vector bundle is associated a sequence of Stiefel-Whitney classes. So, but for this talk, I'm only going to just speak in terms of the group theory for simplicity. Anyway, so they have these properties, and any student of algebraic topology will know these properties. Neha mentioned these earlier in the earlier talk. So it vanishes whenever the index is bigger than the degree. W0 is always one. W1 and W2, I mentioned those on the earlier slides. W1 is basically the determinant. W2 is the cohomology class of the pullback extension coming from the extension from pin over the orthogonal group. W takes direct sums into cup products. I'm assuming you know that You can take cup pyroxene and group cohomology. And this functoriality, this naturality of the thing, saying that if I have a hom between groups, well, then I have any hom here can be composed to get a hom here, a representation there. It'll also be orthogonal. And anyway, and then W of this composition is F star of W of pi, where F star is this map induced on the cohomology, this contravariant functor. Okay, so we're led to this interest in the study of the Stiefel-Whitney classes. And this captures at least two of those questions that I mentioned earlier, once you have orthogonal representations. Okay, so now let me go through some examples. So what are the important classes of groups? Well, one important class is the symmetric groups. So let's talk about that. Okay, so it's well known, and I will assume you know, that irreducible representations of Sn are indexed by partitions of n. I'm going to refer to the corresponding representation as pi sub lambda. The two linear characters are the trivial character and the sine character. Everybody knows that. Okay, and so here's, I wanted to mention this theorem. And this is joint work with Arvind Dyer, who's at IISC, Bangalore, and Mitanshu Prasad and myself. This came out in 2017. One of our theorems is that 100% of Schreck modules have trivial determinant. So you might ask, what happens more often? Is the determinant one or is the determinant sine? And the answer is very much trivial. I mean, very much that it's the trivial representation dominates. And we do more in that paper, but I wanted to highlight this aspect because we actually give explicit formulas for how many chiral and achiral representations there are. Okay, what do I mean by 100% of Schreck modules? So I'm going to be in this talk. I'm going to say 100% a few times, and right now I'll be very explicit about what I mean, but later I'll just say 100%. Okay, so more precisely, the limit as n goes to infinity of the number of partitions of n where the determinant is 1 divided by the total number of partitions of n is equal to 1 as n goes to infinity. Okay, so that's the determinant question. This is some kind of answer to the determinant question. The Frobenius Schur indicator question, they're all orthogonal. Okay, this is a well-known thing. Okay, what about spinoriality? Well, 100% of Schreck modules are spinorial as well. For this, we did a computation. In the paper where we did this computation of the Stiefel-Whitney class, which says that W2 of pi is this integer times W2 of pi n plus this integer times e cup. Okay, so where pi n is, I'm kind of making a basis of H2 of Sn here. Pi n is the standard representation, and e cup is the cup product of W1 of sine with W1 of sine. This thing here within the brackets is not necessarily an integer. It might be a half integer. These brackets means the greatest integer function, but this will be an integer. Okay, so we have this. So I just want to highlight that the features of this is that the main feature that I want to bring out is that this is in terms of character values. Okay, this is the character value at 1. This is the character value at the transposition. This is the character value at the product of two commuting transpositions. But we go further with symmetric groups. So character values of representations of Sn are integers. So we can start asking divisibility questions. Suppose I fix a permutation in some small k. I can view it inside of Sn for n bigger or equal to k. And let's fix some positive integer n. Okay, so another paper with Amri and Jyotimoy. This is my second PhD student, Jyotimoy Ganguly. For 100% of partitions, the character chi lambda of sigma, this character value, is a multiple of D. It's divisible by D. Okay, now from that, you can get this. So using this theorem together with this formula, which is in terms of character values. So this is saying that most of the time, so let's take D equal 8. Okay, well then these characters are all divisible by 8, 100% of the time, say. And W2 is made up of these characters. And oh yes, and the mod 2 cohomology is characteristic 2. So anytime you have an even integer, if this thing here is even, then this is just automatic, this product here is automatically 0, and similarly here. So it turns out that 8 is the thing to check. Okay, now I wanted to mention some upcoming work that we need to finally submit and everything, but just to, so you know what I'm working on. As a corollary, well, using this theorem, we can also show that if you fix a positive integer k, then for 100% of the partitions of n, we have wk of pi lambda is 0. And there's kind of an interesting duality here, because on the other hand, if w of pi is 1, then pi is the trivial representation. So somehow both these things are true at the same time. Okay. So that's symmetric groups. I want to turn now to other groups. So what are other groups that people are interested in besides symmetric groups? Well, alternating groups. And actually the same thing is true for alternating, 100% of the time for alternating groups. But let me move on to the big things. So Lie groups. Lie groups is obviously another family of groups of interest to people. I'll say that G is a connected reductive Lie group. If you don't like reductive, you can say compact. But then I can't give this example. For example, G equals SLN. Irreducible representations of G, there's a well-known parameterization of them. This isn't the place to learn that, but I'll just say the words. These correspond to highest weights, which range over a cone in a certain lattice. And I'm going to write again pi lambda, but this time lambda will refer to this weight of the maximal torus. So here are the answers to some of the questions I put out for these groups. So pi lambda is self-dual if and only if the longest viable group element takes lambda to minus lambda. And these are well-known things, so I'm not writing theorem. Pi lambda is orthogonal if and only if a certain bilinear form applied to lambda and a certain element is even. Okay, so anyway, there's an answer there. We won't really need this, but I wanted to put that there. This is kind of like the dual of rho. Okay, if pi is orthogonal, then the determinant of pi is 1 by connectedness, because I'm taking a connected reductive group. Okay, so I want to mention in this connection a question of Dipendra, just to make things interesting, so it's more personal. I mentioned people that we all know. So Dipendra Prasad, at the group theory Sangam talk, the first group theory Sangam talk, this online seminar that's been going on since COVID, posed this question, does every twofold cover of G arise as the pullback of an orthogonal representation? So I think he wanted this to be true. But anyway, it's a question. It's a good question. And now I'll mention that my first student, Rohit Joshi, and I gave a spinoriality criterion for pi of lambda. So we give a spinoriality criterion that I think I'm not going to mention it here because I'm just surveying things, but we give one in a paper that we wrote, and I guess it was recently published. As part of that, we enumerated the simple groups G with the property that every orthogonal representation is spinorial. So it's not just the simply connected ones. Some of them, for example, PSO8, have fundamental group with even order. And if you think about it, the such groups, both with even fundamental group, so they have double non-trivial double covers, but every orthogonal representation is spinorial. So when you pull back the cover, you get a trivial cover. That gives a negative answer to this question. Okay. So my students, Jyotimoy and Rohit, they have a paper where they extend the spinoriality criterion to orthogonal group, which is not connected. Okay, so they worked out that things get more complex there, but also in terms of character values. So I want to talk about I want to hint at upcoming things I'm doing. Recently, Rohit and I have been looking at Turing classes, which is another kind of characteristic class. And they're defined for any complex representation, not just these orthogonal ones. And they're defined in a certain cohomology. We have proved that this function going from lambda, where the domain is this lattice cone, lambda to CK of pi lambda for a fixed K is polynomial. And we also have shown that C2, the second Turing class, is zero, implies that pi is trivial. So I just was mentioning that as something we're up to. Okay, so we're done with Lie groups. Then there's the question of the finite general linear groups, or more generally finite groups of Lie type. So what happens for GL and Q? So to state something precise, I need in this talk, I want to exclude some small cases. So this is somehow a list of bad pairs. Most of them, Q is even, but there is this GL 2, 3. Now if A1 is this diagonal element, so I'm gonna fix this because I'm gonna be talking about the character value there. And I put m pi to be half of the degree minus chi pi of A1. Then in a paper Rohit and I wrote on GL and Q on the spinoriality problem, we solved that for GL and Q. And the main result, or the main workhorse, is we showed that if Q is 1.14, then it's spinorial if and only if m pi is divisible by 4. If Q is 3.4, it's spinorial if and only if m pi is 0 or 3.4. So with the previous talk in this symposium, my student already presented our work on Stiefel-Whitney classes for G equals SL and Q in the case when n is 2 or n is odd. I guess also Q is odd. One thing that's interesting about this is that automatically the W1 of pi is going to be 0 and the W2 of pi is going to be 0 since G is perfect and since every double cover is automatically trivial. So this is a good group to study if you're interested in looking at W4, the first non-vanishing being W4. I'll mention that my students, Jyotimoy and Rohit, are now working on the total Stiefel-Whitney class for G equals GL and Q. So there's a different kind of situation there. The goal is to compute all of these WK of pi, or express all of these in terms of character values of pi. So that's ongoing. Okay, and maybe I'll stop there.
Thank you, Stephen. Maybe you might need to share your slides to the people who have questions, but yes. Any questions?
Okay.
Thanks. Yeah, yes. Okay, there are no further questions, then let's thank Stephen again. And maybe let me stop recording.